Good morning, church. Welcome to worship with Fairport United Methodist Church. I'm Pastor Richelle Goff, and I welcome you on behalf of the whole congregation. If you are here for the first time, we extend a warm welcome, and we are thankful that you have joined us for worship this morning. For those who are joining us online, we welcome you as well. We have some good news, and that is we're hoping by next Sunday, I'm afraid to even say the words, we might be able to live stream once again, once our internet gets turned over on Friday. So please pray that that happens on Friday so that we can return back to live streaming and handle that. We do have a few announcements as we get started this morning. Actually, there's more than a few. There's a lot going on in the life of our church, which is wonderful. Some of you have seen our email that went out this past week with some of the changes regarding to the reopening task force. Two of those pertain to all of you here in worship, and that is our ushers, as amazing as they are and have been, will not be helping us exit our pews anymore. So you all can do that yourselves, which is wonderful. So you can kind of take your time and exit as you need. And then we are also encouraging folks to be in a time of fellowship if you're comfortable, spread out in the narthex and the parlor as you leave. So it's just encouraging some more connections and building some relationships. So we hope you're able to do that. Out in the narthex, which is that area that you can't, that's right behind the sanctuary, you will see an Advent giving table. I know it's not Advent yet, but we're really, really anxious to get going. And so Fairport Baptist Home is one of the places that we will be helping this Advent. And there's instructions as to what they need. Our church each year for Advent finds ways in which we can help our community. So Fairport Baptist Home, we also are joining alongside of our Sunday school. They, during the month of November, are collecting items for nurses to say thank you for the hard work that they have done, especially during this pandemic. And so we're putting gift bags together for them and delivering them. So I thought, I shared with Joy that maybe that would be a great idea for the congregation to get involved in onto. So that's in the parlor. There's a little sheet, as well as in your weekly e-news, all of the things that they're looking for. Also, we have these little green sheets that are out in the narthex. These are surveys for Christmas Eve. We need to know who wants to come to Christmas Eve and what that evening will look like. And so we had a link in our e-news, and we also have a paper version if you'd like to fill this out. And thank you to, we have already had 120 responses. So thank you for those who've already filled them out. If you haven't, it will be helpful for us to plan how many services that we have on Christmas Eve in order to keep everybody safe and distanced. So thank you again for that. There's 15 more pies left for if you did not pre-order an apple pie from the UMW and you still want one, it is your day. So you can you can still get some more pies. If you need to pick up your pies, they're right in the coat room. You can't miss the UMW after the service. So thank you to Joy. Thank you to everyone who spent so many hours making dough, rolling dough, cutting apples, just gave so much. So thank you so much to all of you. Finally, as we enter into this worship space, we recognized this past week, Veterans Day. And so we want to say thank you to all the veterans who are so selfless and have sacrificed so much, their families and themselves, for us and for our country. And so I'd like to recognize any veterans that have served. You're invited to stand at this moment so that we can recognize you. Thank you. Let us now turn our attention to the call to worship. The God of wisdom calls us to worship.
In humility, we gather to offer our thanks and praise.
The God of peace calls us to let go of our cares and worries. The God of past, present, and future welcomes us into this moment. Let us worship God together.
Hallelujah. Let us praise the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
Lord of light and life, we come before you in wonder and awe, eager to praise your name and enjoy in your presence. You are the source of all that is good and true, the essence of love. You bring gifts of peace and healing into troubled lives. You show us the way to love friend and enemy alike, to build a better world together. In this time of worship, inspire us to believe our work in Jesus' name makes a difference. So may we live to bring your glory, O God, now and always. Amen. Please remain standing in body or spirit for the prayer of illumination and the reading of the gospel for this Sunday. O Lord, teach us your ways and give us the grace to follow them. Give us eyes to see the world as you do. Give us hearts to love others as you do. And give us the wisdom to discern how best to live as followers of Jesus, your living word. Amen. The gospel this morning is from Mark, chapter 13, verse 1 through 8. As he came out of the temple, one of his disciples said to him, "Look, teacher, what large stones and what large buildings." Then Jesus asked him, "Do you see these great buildings? Not one stone will be left here upon another. All will be thrown down." When he was sitting on the Mount of Olives opposite the temple, Peter, James, John, and Andrew asked him privately, "Tell us, when will this be, and what will be the sign that all these things are about to be accomplished?" Then Jesus began to say to them, "Beware that no one leads you astray. Many will come in my name and say, 'I am he,' and they will lead many astray. When you hear of wars and rumors of wars, do not be alarmed. This must take place, but the end is still to come. For nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. There will be earthquakes in various places. There will be famines. This is but the beginning of the birth pangs. For the word of God in Scripture, for the word of God among us, for the word of God within us. Thanks be to God.
I invite the children to come forward for the children's message. And I'm just going to ask you all just to kind of spread out a little bit. There we go. How's everybody doing today? Is everybody good? I know it's a little chilly in here. Yeah, it's because, well, that's good. You've got a nice sweater on. Oh. We need to keep the windows open to sort of keep the flow of air going, but we might have to rethink some of that. I know. It could just blizzard right in here. You're right. Oh, my goodness. A winter wonder church. I love that. We're really getting into the spirit today, aren't we? So I wanted to talk to you a little bit about our scripture today that Mr. Nate shared with us. But before that, how many of you ever gone on a car trip? How many of you, you've gone to Lake Ontario? How many have been further than that? Yeah. How many hours have you been in the car? What does anyone, 6 hours? Oh, yes, we have. Where have you been, Joshua? Anywhere long? North Carolina, that's more than 6 hours. So I'm wondering, have any of you, I used to do this when I used to go to my grandma and grandpa's, and my grandma and grandpa's house from my parents' house when I grew up was only 2 hours away, but there was something I always said, and I'm wondering if you said it too. Are we there yet? Yeah. Have you ever said that? Yeah? Yeah. Millions of times? I know. It's something that drives me bonkers in the car with Karis and Zoe sometimes, you know. And I did drive my mom bonkers too, yes. I'm sure. when you're in the car, though, what else do you see other than keep asking, like, are we there yet? Because we're anxious. There's things that we see. There's lots of signs, road signs, right? What kind of signs did you see? Yeah, advertising like where there's food or gas or lodging, right? And we see signs for the speed limits. Hopefully we're going by those, right? What else do we see? What other kind of signs on the road? Stop signs. Stop. What else? Crossing signs for like deer, animal crossings. What other kind of crossings? Thanks, Karis. Yes, we... Okay. We're going to move on from that. You see all kinds of signs on the road that kind of tell us what's ahead, right? Tell us what's ahead. And in thinking about signs, that was a lot that was in our scripture reading today from the Gospel of Mark. Jesus is preparing his disciples because there's going to be a time when Jesus is not there with them. And he's saying that there's going to be signs. There's going to be signs of a time when we will be able to be all together, right? And I want to talk about what some of those signs might look like for us. So I want you to give me examples. So it's signs of whenever we see God's love at work. And that is sort of hopeful. Right? So what are some signs, or who brings some signs in our lives of God's light and love and hope? What can you think of, Dorothy? Oh. Yes, when we hear someone sing something beautiful, right? And a message of God's love, that is a sign, right? What else could be a sign? Like a road sign. Joshua. Oh, whether it's safe to cross or not. So there's the people that help us, maybe. People who help us and guide us along the way. Yes, that's wonderful as well. I know that I have people in my life, like friends and family and church members who show me what Jesus' love looks like. And to me, that's a sign of God's love, right? So I want you to know that we are to share signs of love with our church and with our community, kind of like we're a big billboard for God's love everywhere we go. A giant billboard saying, God loves you. You can't miss us, right? Yes. 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 Exactly. So how about we put our hands together, quiet our minds, and say a prayer. Thank you, O God, for all the signs in our lives of your love, especially your son, Jesus. Make us signs of your love and hope for the whole world to see like a big billboard. Remind us to not be afraid, but to trust your promise to be with us always. And all of God's children said, amen. All right, thank you, guys. You can go back to your seats. Let us pray. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of each and every one of our hearts be pleasing and acceptable to you, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So I hope that all of you have had your coffee for the morning and that you are ready to hit the ground running this morning. Are we? Yeah, maybe. We need to get up and do some exercises or do some sit-down exercises to get our blood going this morning. But today's scripture passage for us is not what I would call an easy one for us to process and digest. This morning, we start right off the bat with Jesus foretelling the destruction of the temple. This passage is from the Gospel of Mark. And it's from the 13th chapter. And I think it's really helpful for us to put into context where this comes in the whole gospel. A lot of scholars refer to this specific chapter, chapter 13, in which we heard the first 8 verses as the little apocalypse. Dun, dun, dun. This chapter separates the gospel narrative, which concluded at the end of chapter 12, from the passion narrative, which will begin in 14. So we have this little in-between time. And there's a whole lot of whoa factor going on in our scripture reading today. Jesus' tone is completely different than what we've heard up to this point in Mark. It's very different than the rest of the book. And if we're honest with ourselves, it's a little unsettling. It's a little unsettling, a little scary. Did you get a whole bunch of like warm fuzzies when we heard the scripture being read this morning? Not so many warm fuzzies this morning with that scripture. It's a little scary, some of what we heard. And over the years, Christians, alarmists, have used this chapter to sort of like invoke all kinds of fear in people when they talk about salvation and the end of times. Kind of reminiscent of our text last week, if you were all with us last week, for the reading that we had from the book of Revelation. But the important thing in all of that, the takeaway for for us is to remember that this chapter is talking about a transition. A transition between the world as it is and the world as it will be when Jesus is no longer physically present. And Jesus, knowing what's about to happen, I mean, up to this point in Mark, if you had been reading the whole chapter, you would have heard three times Jesus foretelling his death up to this point. And so he's talking about what it will take for the disciples. He's laying the groundwork for the disciples of how they can be sustained in ministry without him, how they can carry on the mission and the ministry that Jesus has called them to, how they will witness to the hope of God's love in the midst of the chaos in the world around them. That's what Jesus is preparing them and teaching them about. I don't know about you, but it sounds like some pretty good advice for us in this time and in this place. Amen? Jesus says, when you hear of wars and rumors of wars, do not be alarmed. In other words, don't be afraid. God will still be with you in the midst of that. God's love will be more powerful than conflict or fear or violence or whatever is going on. You, I am calling you to be agents of hope. Agents of hope, instruments of peace in this world. You will shine God's light into the world even when the darkness I'm describing threatens to overcome it. I think despite its somewhat terrifying apocalyptic language, this passage that we have for us today has so much to teach us about church, about doing church, about being church. Now follow me. I hope you can follow me on this. And I think especially with how we are experiencing the pandemic and life during a pandemic right now, I think this is in particular very, very helpful for us. You know, it's not always easy to be church or to do church, right? It can be really hard work. It's not easy to do what we do. I mean, we're not on the brink of an apocalypse or anything, but I do think over the past few years, we've experienced and we are continuing to experience some pretty big transitions when it comes to church. The pandemic didn't cause the transition, but it pretty much brought it along a lot faster than maybe we were anticipating or ready for. Kind of put it on fast forward for us. And if we're honest, we've seen the church change a lot. For a long time, it's been in the midst of transition. People, in general, are reprioritizing their lives. Where does church fit? What does church look like? What should church look like? Some people decided not to come back to church because it's not where they found community. Some people learned that their community of faith was what they longed for the most. And some recognized that it's something they really wanted. Some people have stepped away from leadership roles, and some people have embraced new leadership roles. And that means some hard things. Letting new people lead in their way. It means giving up some control. Not easy to do. As a church, we're in the process of trying to align our staff with the missional needs of our church and our community. We celebrate, we have new families, new people coming to our church and supporting the church. That's amazing as we are wrapping up our stewardship campaign. Many people have given more this year than they have in the past, which is excellent. But we still have a deficit budget. You know, half of our membership has not returned since COVID hit. It's so hard to plan with those realities, and yet it's also exciting It's exciting to see what new thing God has in store for us. Our denomination is on the brink of something new. It's in the discernment process of a split, probably, in the denomination, which is, you know, very confusing. It's scary for some people. It's sad for some people. And for others, it's liberating, so that the church can live out the way that it needs to. It's not easy to do church. It's not easy to be church. Well, and if we're honest, it never has. It's never been easy, and I guess that's the point. It's not easy. It certainly brings its own set of challenges in each time that we live. And in all of the times, we're just trying to find grace and trying to find meaning in the midst of the chaotic world that we find ourselves living in, a world that sometimes feels exactly like the world that Jesus is describing in our scripture passage today. And it can feel so daunting. But remember what Jesus says. Do you remember? Do not be alarmed. And when I hear that, I hear, Richelle, don't freak out. Don't freak out. For this is an unsettling and a little scary piece of scripture. And we have to think about the disciples. They must have been terrified when Jesus first said these words. But remember, we're not the disciples in that time and place. We are reading it. We are hearing it as people of the resurrection. We know how the story is going to end. And despite the chaos and darkness that Jesus is talking about, we still see the light. And despite the destruction, the persecution, we know that in the end of all of this, that God's love will win. And that's the whole of Scripture, that God's love always wins. And so despite any challenges that we face as we seek to be the church that God's called us to be, we are people of the resurrection. To believe in the power of that love and to be agents of that hope is what we are about. That's our focus. This past July marked my 16th year of pastoral ministry, and I've served 4 great churches over those years, 3 different appointments. I served in Oswego and Martville. That is a place. Many of you have not heard it. And Auburn, and here now in Fairport. And I've been here for 3.5 years. 3.5 years of doing and being church. Of shining light into the world, being the body of Christ. 3.5 years of worship services, Zoom calls, in person, at home, recording, Bible studies, suppers, fundraisers, community and family events. 3.5 years of making meals, pies, soups, prayer quilts, face masks, showing up and being present when people need us, the church, the most. 3.5 years of stepping on toes, making mistakes together, having frustrations, but also sharing in successes and joys. 3.5 years of discernment about who we are and who God is calling us to be in this world today. Has it been perfect? No. We're human. We're not perfect. But has it been grace-filled? Certainly. Certainly. And just like it will in this story, because remember, as people of the resurrection, we read this mini apocalypse knowing how it's going to end. We know love has won over and over and over again. Love is what wins. So I'm being very honest when I say that in my 3.5 years here, I've never been more exhausted. but I've also never felt the kind of passion and excitement for the church than I do right now. I think that the Holy Spirit is moving our church together, that we are heeding the call of Jesus to keep awake, and that we must continue to be intentional about everything that we do. We need to be listening to God speaking to us, recognizing God's presence among us, and watching God at work in and among us. In the midst of the chaos and sometimes scary world that we live in, we are sharing the good news of God's love, and it's a privilege and it's an honor to do that together. For we are doing it together. We're not alone. God has placed us on a journey, and God's Spirit goes ahead of us. God's Spirit is with us, alongside of us, and is behind us, all around us. And so my question for us this morning is, are we up for it? Are we up for listening to where God is calling us next? How God is calling us to be church in this time and in this place? We read this passage today and we acknowledge the brokenness in our world. But I also want us to celebrate what we've done and what we do in God's name. Because what we do here at church literally changes lives. And you are all a part of it. God uses you. God uses us to help change lives, transform lives. God is the one that's leading and guiding. We are the ones to be listening and showing up. We are the ones God is using to be agents of hope and grace in this world. We hear in Scripture, this is but the beginning of birth pangs. Because God is birthing something new here, friends. What will it be? What will it look like? We don't know exactly, but we do know that we have a God that brings hope out of despair and life out of death, something out of nothing, some bodies out of nobodies, beauty out of brokenness. And so what I do know is that it will be amazing. And we will experience it together as the church. Thanks be to God. Amen. Thank you, choir. That was beautiful. As we enter into our time of prayer this morning, I do remind you that our prayer list is always printed on the back of the bulletin, all of the different people and situations that are requiring our prayers. I do want to lift up that we have two grieving families in our church. Please keep the Hesney family, Rick Hesney, in your prayers as his wife Judy passed away this week. We prayed for her last week as she entered into hospice care. Her funeral will be on Sunday, next Sunday, at 2 o'clock. And so please hold Rick and the family in your prayers, as well as Marjorie Rose, whose brother Dick passed away. So please keep Marjorie in your prayers as well. We have several other prayer requests that are listed here. We also want to recognize all the transgender lives that have been lost this past year. There is a Transgender Day of Remembrance at Martin Luther King Jr. Park in Rochester, and our church is joining other faith communities. It's an interfaith event next Saturday at 4 o'clock, and people from our congregation are welcome to come as we remember and honor those lives. I know that many of you have other prayers that are on your hearts, and so what we will do is just spend a moment in silence where you can lift those up, knowing God hears each and every one of our requests. God of our past and future, God of healing and hope, we come before you this morning with grateful hearts, trusting that you walk with us through all the different times in our lives. So we pray today for those who face danger and despair, for those who live with hunger each day, for communities struggling with natural disasters, and all those for whom the pandemic is unrelenting. We lift up people caught up in unrest and violence, and we pray for all those working to relieve suffering in all of these different ways. We pray this day for all those facing fear and frustrations, wrestling with sorrow and grief, or discouragement, for those who live with illness or pain, with chronic conditions. And we pray for all those who work to bring healing and comfort. We pray for all who feel helpless or hopeless, for those struggling to make ends meet, for those caught up in the pain of misunderstanding or broken relationships, for those working through situations of conflict at home or work. And we pray for all who offer guidance and support. God of our past and our future, God of healing and hope, help our church and every church to engage each day with faithfulness. Where we need correction, show us the way. Where we need love and encouragement, draw near. Whatever our challenge, stay with us on our way and help us to be agents of your hope. For we are the followers of Jesus who pray together in his name. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I invite you to stand in body or spirit for our final hymn, View the Present Through the Promise. It's in the Worship and Song, if you're not familiar. It's the green book. Green. Friends, as you leave this time of worship, whether you're in person or at home, as you go out into the world that is sometimes chaotic, don't freak out. God is with us, and God's Spirit is behind us and beside us and in front of us, and will strengthen us to all that God has called us to do, to be agents of hope. Agents of God's peace in this time and place. May you go filled with that hope and with that love always. Amen.